Nightlife on the floating island is exciting, so says the Sonic 3 instruction manual. And the circus jingle in Carnival Night makes this apparent too. Everyone can recognize the main melody as That Circus Song, an 1897 piece by Czech composer Julius Fučík called Entrance of the Gladiators, which he composed as a military march, but just a few years later a Canadian arranged the big band version we associate with the circus today. The song's working title was The Great Chromatic March, reflecting the composition's use of chromatic scales. Endless Mine included movement down 4 adjacent notes in a row, but this circus jingle makes its way down 10 chromatic steps without skipping any notes. Carnival Night uses this melody as a setup to reach different tonal destinations, such as this chord's 5 and 1. Sonic 2's Mystic Cave has a similar chromatic tumbledown, cueing up the circus of horrors in the scary caves. And like Carnival Night, it uses the motif to navigate to the 5 and the 1. Brad Buxer's squad doesn't use complex chord changes, and Carnival Night is no exception. The whole song features only the 1 and 5 chords. But instead of going back and forth between the chords, each section tends to hold a single chord for its full duration. Section A just holds the 1 chord, and the bass is totally devoted to this task. This straightforward bass line shows how a little syncopation can go a long way. Because if the bass notes stayed on the main strong beats, it would have been too rigid and by the numbers. But a syncopated pull on every other note adds a great touch of funk. Then section B just holds the song's other chord, the 5. These chords are held for a while, so they can benefit from some extra flavor, and there's plenty of options for notes to stack on top. We saw how Palm Tree Panic took the basic triad and added the 7th. And DKC's Death Music showed how you can add on the flat 7, which we notate on the chord by tacking on that 7 like an exponent. Now you can slide it down from 7 to 6, which is exactly what Carnival Night does. Part of why this works so well is that we're moving down this chord's 7th, 6th, and 5th, but in relation to the ultimate true one of the entire song's key, that's a 4-3-2 walk down, providing a simultaneous context to generate motion leading back to the 1. The Genesis game McDonald's Treasure Land Adventure has a final boss theme that pulls the same stunt on the 5 chord. And Spyro's first hub world shows how you can do this 7-6 slide down on the 4 chord too. And while we slide down this 7-6 ladder, the bass underneath somehow defies the hardware limitations of one note per channel. It's sensible enough to hit the 5 during the 5 chord, but if you listen to the bass, there's also this feedback sound, which is impressive since this is one channel producing two different tones. This isn't just some accidental spillage. The bass note is the 5, and the feedback that emerges is the 7, which fits in the harmony because we're currently playing the 5 chord, comprised of the 5, 7, and 2. So that 7 is rubbing up against the 1, executing one of the important functions that the 5 chord serves. despite using just two chords, the track shows how you can milk a lot of runtime out of a fairly simple composition. Because section A and B together only makes 33 seconds of music, so the composer duplicated the sections, then cut the first section B short before it finishes. That way, the final section B delivers the full, impactful conclusion, allowing the listener to explore the forbidden territory that was teased in the first run-through. And boy, do the final measures have a lot going on. For starters, rapper Heavy D makes a cameo to say the word jam. Twice. It's an audio sample taken from Michael Jackson's 1991 single, Jam, a track that was also the source of this concluding melody. Meaning that Sonic managed to make his way to the Super Bowl. This melody is somewhat disorienting, with notes all over the place and not conforming to a single contour. But when we sift through the commotion, we find that the more important notes in this sequence just walk down chromatically, in the same vein as Entry of the Gladiators. The song Jam uses a similar melodic algorithm, except the chromatic path starts one notch lower, and even keeps going down past the tonic. So it's like both songs take their own glimpse into the same kaleidoscope. As a compositional exercise, it can be fun to identify a melodic pattern, then continue the melody yourself using that overall algorithm. What you get is some kind of four-dimensional cube, folding in upon itself but never collapsing. Anyone who's ridden the zipper knows the feeling of having your spatial orientation twisted up by that ride's rotation on multiple axes. But we get off this ride abruptly, another hint that MJ's songwriting team had a thing for sudden silence where the beat drops out. Carnival Night loops back to the start with a silence like launch bass, but even has two more pauses, including one at the start of the song, bookended by the sounds of shattering glass. This leads to moments where you, as the player, can contribute to the music by using the warp pipes as an instrument. Knuckles Act 1 starts out with a vertical warp tunnel, and you can time the warp noise right when the beat drops out. And in Act 2, Sonic can fill the silence by spamming the chain of Hadron particle accelerators at the start. Sonic soundtracks aren't generally crafted to have music cues coincide with in-game events. The closest example would be prototype Ice Cap, with a pause timed when Sonic kicks up his snowboard, as if you're hitting a crash cymbal on that beat. The start of Proto-Carnival Night is notable for its unsteady rhythm, especially in the version on PC. Did the drummer only get 2 hours of sleep? But it is salvaged on the Genesis sound chip. After the aerial combat of the Marble Garden boss, the intro measures have this alternate rhythm before the real beat, while you regain your footing. Among the prototype zone themes, there's a curious distribution of chords, especially here at the carnival. Ice Cap has just 2 chords total, compared to the others 12 and 10. These numbers are somewhat inflated because these 2 tracks have numerous key changes. Removing that factor, it's closer to 8. But clearly, these proto-tracks get deliberately ambitious to pave a path between numerous keys, and at the carnival especially, because the key changes between acts are totally different. Act 1 changes key for the final section, and Act 2 key changes out of its minor keyed intro, only to change again soon after to E-flat major, the same key that Act 1 began with. So there's a fantastic odyssey ahead, but things don't start off too encouraging due to Section A's uninspired use of the Mixolydian scale, a very common scale that takes the major scale, then changes the 7 to minor. It's not that this modification adds a touch of darkness to an otherwise bright scale, More so that the normal major 7 is super noticeable to the ear, the way it rubs right up against the 1. So flatting it just kinda de-emphasizes it, so it's just hanging out with the other notes. The opening tremolo sequence of Angel Island sits on this Mixolydian 7th for a few beats. Act 1 begins with some dull, stepwise movement between the three pillars of the 1 chord, 1, 3, 5. This color-by-numbers composition is pretty basic. It's not the kind of song that inspires you to learn a new instrument. And the concluding melody of the section is particularly pedestrian. At best, this captures the feeling of waiting in line for a ride, which makes it all the more remarkable that the Act 2 equivalent is one of the most catchy and lively melodies in the soundtrack, drilling some fantastic syncopation on that Mixolydian 7th. For that matter, Act 2's intro immediately lets you know you're in for it, as if the crowd of spectators are clapping in rhythm to say, "All right, Sonic, show us what you got. Can you get through Act 2 without getting a time over?" Hope you enjoyed waiting in line in Act 1, because things are about to get real, with these dissonant intervals hinting that playtime is over. What with bats that track you down when you inevitably get tripped up in these bumpers? And a cool octave hop that's barely noticeable in Act 1 becomes prominent and memorable in the Act 2 remix. See how this lead melody takes up most of these measures, with only one gap? If the background instrument wants to make noticeable moves, it's best to do so during the lead melody's downtime. Because while the lead is active, the supporting line performs its normal rhythm duties, but in that brief downtime it seizes the opportunity to jump upward by octave. You know how at carnivals, every so often you hear a wave of screams in the distance as a roller coaster zooms over a high octane peak? Now the moment of the waiting in line melody is quite different in Act 2, but even this overhaul has its own concern that a composition professor might take issue with. It's this melodic movement between the 1 and the 4, because when you're making big jumps up from the 1, you get the most stability by landing on 3, 5, or 8. But going back and forth by leaps to a note like the 4 can feel forced and unnatural, especially when singing aloud. Welcome to Carnival Night Zone. We can sacrilegiously imagine an alternate melody that might have pleased that composition professor, making use of the neighbor tones on either side of the 4. Then the final section is the song's powerhouse of excitement, of just having a blast at a carnival, especially in Act 2. Cause Act 1 just trudges through the steady-as-she-goes chords, and the way the melody follows it down in lockstep is borderline boring. But get your heartstrings ready in Act 2, cause Section C takes you back to the amazing memories you had at carnivals as a kid. Unlike Act 1, this final section sheds the Mixolydian modifier in favor of the major 7th, boosting the joyous energy to peak levels. And the rhythm instruments really put that major 7th to use. And just like an endless mine, using that note this way is a fast track for nostalgic reminiscence. This is the only section across both acts that does not contain the 5 chord. Doing away with that chord's challenging dissonance lets you relish the joys of the carnival, with the uncomplicated splendor of the 1 and 4 chords. You made it! Turn those lights back on, and notice how the 4 chord contains the 1, so it doesn't make as many waves. All we need in life now is the cheerful simplicity of these two chords, bobbing gently up and down with your merry-go-round horse. And yet it's not all serene smiles, because half the fun of a carnival are those moments of frightening excitement, which is delivered here in the 4th measure by borrowing some notes from the minor scale, followed by a quick, "That was crazy, but on we go." But But we can't just ride these chords into the sunset, because with all these ambitious key changes, the song's loop needs to bring everything back home to the original key. Experienced composers talking shop can tell you about the challenge of changing keys between sections, then needing to come up with a tricky maneuver to bring it all back home for the song's loop, as Grant Kirkhope elaborates on the Composer Code podcast.
In my own head, right, I was trying to compose myself into a corner and then try to get back from that corner back to the home key by some convoluted, nonsensey series of fifths or tritones, whatever it was.
Section C is in the key of A flat major, so the ending needs to bring things back home to the original key of E flat major. Some songs execute this stealthily to avoid drawing attention, but this track takes a brute force approach with this gnarly resetter of a chord. It's a brutal way to cleanse the palate for a return to the original key. In relation to the destination key, this chord includes a note right above the target tonic and another note right underneath it, making for a clear but pushy path toward our destination. And the chord sounds so apprehensive thanks to a double dose of the devil. The distance between these two notes is 6 semitones, aka the devil's interval, which generates that worrisome, tense sting. And with another devil's interval in between the other two notes, this resetter chord doubles down on discomfort, at the realization you shouldn't have eaten that corn dog right before riding the zipper. Act 2 loops the song with a gnarly resetter chord of the exact same shape, with the same two tritones, which somehow works even though this time the edge notes are not anywhere near the destination tonic. Curious how the prototype song ends with this off-the-wall dissonance, and similarly the Genesis version concludes with the disorienting shape-shifting of the imploding melody, because any good carnival has rides that twist up your spatial orientation like a pretzel. And with all these great soundtrack options, how are you supposed to decide which song should play in each act? The CDC recommends using the Michael Jackson versions for Act 1 and the prototype tracks for Act 2. This way, you begin each zone with the canon iconic songs that the world grew up with on Sega hardware. After all, most of us do insist on hearing the original Ice Cap tune for the snowboarding sequence. Then, not only does Act 2 give you a new composition from the PC release, but it's the exciting, upbeat reimagined version of its Act 1 equivalent. Trading in the waiting in line melody for the syncopated upgrade is as good a reason as any. And when you make it to the carousel chords, you've arrived. Pick any ride you want to ride, seize the excuse to eat cotton candy and jumbo pretzels, and savor the thrills and laughter with the people you love and trust.